UPSC. So if you haven't watched the previous part, that's part 1, part 2 and part 3, make sure you watch it and then continue watching. So let's get into the video. So in the previous session I told you we were discussing about the applications. I discussed about one, that was what meter bridge. Wheatstone's bridge also we discussed. Now there's one more, that is potentiometer. So potentiometer is the topic for today, what we are going to discuss. So potentiometer is a device which is used to measure EMF and internal resistance of a wire. So let's see the setup. Before seeing the setup, I'll discuss the principle behind it, and then we'll see the setup and what all are the parts of a potentiometer. So first we'll discuss about the principle of potentiometer, and then we'll see the parts of it and then the rest. So let's see. The principle of potentiometer is: the fall of potential across any portion of a conductor is directly proportional to the length of that portion, provided is there are conditions. The first condition is the area of cross section should be what? Uniform. And secondly, the current flowing through it should be constant. So the conditions are uniform, area of cross section and constant current. So now, since we know that there should be a uniform area and current, let us derive the equation. So now let's derive the equation. So we'll take a conductor of uniform area of cross section, length L, and then what else? Then potential difference V and resistivity rho. Okay, so now what we are going to do, we are going to derive the equation from Ohm's law. So what is Ohm's law? V is equal to I into R. Am I right? So V is equal to I into, what is the equation? Sorry, what's the equation for R? R is equal to rho L divided by A. So we write rho L divided by A. Am I right? So now we know that V is equal to K L. What is this? K is a constant. The value of K, or the value of K is I rho pi A. So from here, what did we derive? That potential is directly proportional to length. Isn't that what we said? The potential difference across a conductor in a certain portion is directly proportional to the length, provided some conditions for the area of cross section is uniform. And then what did we say? There was a constant current passing through it. Okay? A constant current passing through it. So we discussed about the law. Now let's see the structure, or how does a potentiometer look. We drew a meter bridge. Okay? By the way, potentiometer wire is made up of either constandin or magnin. So let us see the diagram. So in a wooden piece, okay, this is a wooden piece, we have a wire connected, okay? It is bent like this. This is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So the length of the wire can vary from 4, 6 and 10. Okay, 4 meter wire, 6 meter wire and 10 meter wire, because the connection should come in the same side. You can't have only this much. Either you have to have 4, 6, 8 can also be possible, but we have a standard potentiometer of lengths 4 meter, 6 meter and 10 meter. Okay, so these are two points, A and B. This is the constandin or magnet wire, and this is connected. We have an external circuit. Here there is a battery or a cell. Here there is a rheostat. Okay, that is connected to B. Over here we have a cell also. Not a cell, sorry. We have a key. And see that now the circuit is complete. And now we have a joke key here, because we said the applications of Wheatstone's bridge. So there's a jokey here. And now let's see how it works, what all are its uses, etc. So this is the diagram. This is a wooden board. This is the Constantinomagnon wire of length 4 meter, 6 meter, or 10 meter. This is the external circuit. This is the key. Sorry, this is the battery or cell. This is the rheostat. And this is the key. This is the galvanometer on the jockey. So by adjusting this length, you will get a zero diffraction. That is when you say a potentiometer is balanced. So now we'll discuss about the applications of a potentiometer. So the first application is comparison between EMF of two cells. So let's draw. This is the wire. I'm not drawing it. I'm just drawing dots so you can understand that. And then we have to have two cells over here. So let's mark the two cells. This is the point A and this is point B. So the cells would be two cells, no? Positive side and the negative side. This is a carbon. One side is a carbon electrode and it has two cells. These two make up a cell, these two make up a cell. So let's connect it to a wire. Here there is a rheostat, and over here there is a key, it's connected to B, and this is connected to A, okay? And from here, what is there? A jockey. This is the setup of a cell for comparing the EMFs. So this is E1. Okay, these two make up E1. This and this. And E2 is this and this. Okay, I hope you understood. So let's see. If you have to compare the both of them, what should we do? I'll explain this figure again. This is the Magnon or Constantin wires. This is the wooden board, this is the galvanometer, this is the jockey, this is the cell 1 and this is the cell 2, which is there for comparison. This is the rheostat. Why is the rheostat given? That is, like, there shouldn't be a change in current, or there should be a constant current. So that is why there is a rheostat. And over here is the key, okay? And these two are the ends, okay? So let's see. When you adjust the jockey to a particular length, it can be anywhere in the wire, when you adjust it to a particular length, the galvanometer deflection would be zero, or zero galvanometer deflection. There is no deflection in the galvanometer. So what did we learn? We learned that EMF is directly proportional to what? Length. Okay? So what, like we said, potential is directly proportional to length. So if this key is not connected, that is the EMF itself. So E is proportional to L. Therefore what will happen? EMF of this cell, the voltage of this cell is equal to what? KL1. This would be length 1 when you take into consideration about this. So this is E1 is equal to KL1. And what is E2? The same case, KL2. So when you compare E1 by E2, it is equal to what? L1 by L2. So you have compared the EMF. You have to compare the EMF between E1 and E2. If you know the balancing length of both of them, E1 and E2, then it's easier to find the comparison. So let's see the next application. Before we discuss about the potentiometer, the second application, let's discuss about what is the sensitiveness of a potentiometer. When you say something is sensitive, or you say it gives you a sensitive value, it is when it gives you a very, very accurate value for a special reaction or a special, action taking place. So let's see what is the sensitiveness of a potentiometer. To say, if a potentiometer is sensitive, it can show accurate value of the EMF and the internal resistances. So, to talk about the sensitiveness is a factor that can be adjusted with the help of increasing the length and decreasing the current. So what is it? First one is increasing length and decreasing current, what will happen? The sensitiveness of a of a potentiometer increases. So the sensitive, if you say a potentiometer is sensitive, it means the K value is very less. So what did we learn? V is proportional to K L. If the value of K is small, then V is directly proportional to L. So it's very sensitive. As length changes, then there would be a change in what? The voltage. So okay. And I said K is equal to what? I rho L divided by A. Am I right? So if K is equal to I rho L divided by A, can you equate K from this? We learned, V is equal to KL. Sorry, not proportional. V is equal to KL. So K is equal to V by L. Something or quantity divided by length is called as what? Gradient. So what is this? This is potential gradient. So I just mentioned it over here. That's it. So now we'll see the second application. So let's learn the second application. The second application is determination of the internal resistance of a cell. So let us see the second application. Over here there's a small change in our diagram, a very small change. So let us see what is that change and how can you identify the resistance. So discussing about the second application, let's write. First thing, you have to draw it, no? So this is the wooden board. This is the wire. This B point. This is the A point. And let's connect the key, the rheostat. And now we have something known as a cell. So let's connect the cell. This is the cell. Let's connect it over here. The cell is connected to what? There is a internal resistance and a key. Okay, now the key is open. So how do you find out the EMF of a cell, or how do you find, so not the EMF, how do you find the internal resistance of a cell? So let us see over here, and then we have a jokhi. Okay, I forgot to mention about the jokhi. From here, a galvanometer and a jokhi. So now we'll adjust the length of the jokhi when the key is, let's take the case of when key is open. Okay, the key is open, this is not closed. So when the key is open, the galvanometer shows a zero deflection at say a length over here. Okay, or somewhere, let's say it makes a length somewhere. So that when the key is open, the voltage or the voltmeter reading, what would be that? That is the EMF of a cell. So what did we find out? We according to the potentiometer principle, EMF or the voltage of a cell is equal to is proportional to the length. So we will write it as, this should be without closing the cell of this region, we will say it as EMF, because it is EMF, it's not a closed cell, it's an open cell, so it's an EMF. EMF is proportional to L1. Okay. And the next one is, we close it, okay? We close this. When you close it, what is this over here? What would be the potential difference across here? That is terminal potential difference, that is denoted by V. So V is proportional to what? L2. Okay? So now we know both are actually E only. So let's see by comparing them. E by V is equal to L1 divided by L2. Am I right? Do we know the equation for E? What is the equation for E? E is equal to 1 plus R divided by R into V. So what is E by V? E by V is equal to 1 plus R divided by R. So let us substitute this over here. Let us wait. So I'll rub this and then I'll write. So 1 plus R divided by R is equal to L1 divided by L2. So what is that we have to find out? We find out R. Okay? Sorry, we don't write this R by R. We write the other way. Around R divided by R. That is internal resistance divided by external resistance. Okay? It was minus 6. So it's 1 plus R divided by R is equal to L1 by L2. Okay? So what will happen over here? Now we can take this 1 to the other side. So R by R is equal to L1 by L2 minus 1. Am I right? This will go there with the minus 1. And then to find out R, what should you do? Nothing much. Just put a bracket, take the R from here and put the R over here. So this is the equation for internal resistance that we found out from what? From the potentiometer. So now it is an application of potentiometer. So that is all the talk about potentiometer. Next we have to discuss about something known as heating effect. So Joule's heating law, we have learned about it. So let's see what is it in detail. So now we discuss about the Joule's heating effect. So the word heating, there's something getting heated up or it's hot. So let's see what it is. When a conductor is having a current flow through it, after a short period of time or after a period of time, the conductor would get heated up, okay? That is known as the Joule's heating effect. Let's see the equation for that. So we know what voltage is work by charge. Therefore, what is work? Voltage into charge. So we learned that work. What is the work done by a cell? The work done by a cell is to move a charge from high potential to low potential, or to move a charge from low potential to high potential. So that is the work. Now let's see what is the I, current. I, current is equal to charge by time. So we don't have I over here. Instead, what do we have? We have Q. So we have to find out Q. Q is equal to I into T. Now let's substitute this equation over here. This is 1, this is 2. So let's substitute 2 and 1. So what did we get? And by the way, work. When you do work, okay. See, now my hands are not working. They are in rest. When you rub, what happens? There is something produces, heat produced. So the work done produces heat. That is the work. That's the result of work. Therefore, what? This is equal to, work done is equal to heat. Okay? So we write W is equal to H is equal to what? V into Q. Okay, V into Q is equal to V into IT. Therefore, H is equal to VIT. Okay? And now we'll substitute the value for V. We know V is equal to IR. So let's substitute that. H is equal to IR into IT. Am I right? So what will it become? This is equal to I square RT. See, this is our second equation for Joule's heating effect. So the first equation is this one. The second equation is this one. Next, V is equal to I into R. So what? We have the equation over here. We have I and R. So let's take I square. So we'll substitute I over here. So I is equal to V by R. Let's substitute this over here. So what is it? H is equal to I square RT. So V square by R square into R into T. So 1 R will get cancelled, 1 R will get cancelled. So what it will be? V square T divided by R. So our third equation for Joule's law is V square T divided by R. So this is the third equation. From Joule's heating effect, we learn that H is equal to I square RT. So we got that H is proportional to I square, H is proportional to R, H is proportional to T. Okay? So this is when the value is in joules. So now if it is in calories, what will happen? In calories, if you have to write it, the value would be H is equal to I square RT divided by 4.2 is for calories. So friends, that's all for today's session. I hope you might have liked it. If you have liked it and understood it, please do give my video a huge thumbs up and also subscribe to my channel if you're watching my channel for the first time. And also share my videos to your other friends. So see you on my next video. Till then, bye-bye.